I've been using the Nik collection for well over a decade because the selection tools make it easy to produce great photography. In today's video, I'll share 7 selection techniques you can use with Nik Color Efex Pro 4 to improve your results. Hello, I'm Robin Worley and welcome to LensCraft. Here's the image we'll be using today, which I've already opened in Nik Color Efex Pro. The first technique I want to share is the global opacity adjustment, which is often overlooked. It's also easy to dismiss this, but it's much more important than you might realise, as you'll see later in the video. I'll demonstrate this now using the Pro Contrast filter by increasing the dynamic contrast slider to its maximum value. This makes it easier to see what's happening. If I toggle the filter's visibility off and on, you can see the effect that it's having on the image. In Color Efex Pro, the individual filters each have a control point section below them. When I expand the section, you can see that there's an opacity slider with a default setting of 100%. Now watch what happens to the image when I gradually reduce the opacity down to 0. You can see that it's starting to hide the effect of the filter. When the opacity gets down to 0%, the filter's effect is completely hidden. If I toggle the filter visibility off and on, you can see that it's not affecting the image. Using the opacity slider is helpful in controlling the overall strength of the filter without needing to change any of the filter sliders. But the opacity slider also has another use because it works in conjunction with control points. Control points are used to select and adjust only parts of an image in the Nik collection, and they're implemented slightly differently in each of the plugins. You can see what happens if I add a control point to select the foreground rock. To add the control point, I first need to click the icon showing the plus sign. I can then move my mouse pointer to the position where I want to place it. Then when I click, you see the new control points added in that position. The way the control point works is by sampling the area of the image at its center. It then uses the luminance and color information from that point to determine what should be selected in the image. Areas with similar luminance and colour are then selected whilst other areas are excluded. You'll also see 2 sliders on the control point. The top slider controls the size of the control point. Move it to the right to make the control point larger and to the left to make it smaller. We'll be coming back to look at the other slider shortly. Now, because where you position the control point is so important, you might want to magnify that area. I find an easy way to do this is by using the loop view that's combined in the histogram panel. This then displays the area below the mouse pointer magnified to 100%. If I click and drag the control point with my mouse, you can see a small cross appears on the loop view to indicate its position. For this image, I'll position the control point on the lichens of the rock. Watch the effect change in that area of the image as I reposition the control point. This is one of the strengths of the control point because you can get real-time feedback as you move it around. Now, although you get real-time feedback as you move the control point, there's also a selection mask generated that you don't see, but it can be useful to make selections. The way to view the mask is by clicking the small tick box to the right of the control point in the control point list. Then, rather than viewing the image, you see a black and white mask. The lighter areas of the mask indicate what's being selected by the control point and therefore what's affected by the filter. The lighter an area of the mask is, the stronger the filter's effect will be in that area. Equally, the dark areas of the mask hide the filter's effect and the black areas conceal it completely. Earlier we looked at the opacity slider, which was set at 100%. Notice it's now set to 0%. This happened when I added the control point to the image. It's also why the rest of the mask is now black and only the area selected by the control point is white. Watch what happens when I increase the opacity to 100%. The entire mask turns white, meaning that the filter's now affecting the entire image again. If I turn off the mask view by clicking the tick box again, you can see that it's affecting the entire image. When I reduce the opacity, it hides the filter's effect except for where the control point is. But watch what happens if I partially increase the opacity slider to around 40%. Now the filter's affecting the entire image, but at a lesser strength than the area selected by the control point. If we go back to the mask view, you can see the overall mask is now grey rather than black. At the same time, the area of the mask selected by the control point is still light because that area is selected at full strength. Let's set the opacity slider back to 0% because there's something else that I want to show you. When I click on the centre of the control point as though I want to move it, you can see it's got an outside edge. Except this isn't really the outside edge. Notice that the lighter areas of the mask extend well beyond this edge. What's really happening is that the area within the circumference of the control point is being selected at full strength. Then beyond this, areas with similar colour and luminance to the selection point are selected but at a lower opacity. The further the area is away from the control point, the lower the opacity of that selection. It's this gradual feathering of the selection that helps to blend any adjustments you make into the image. In this example, if I make the control point large enough to select the lichens on the surrounding rocks, it also spills over into the sky. One way to control this is by using a negative control point. To add a negative control point, click on the minus control point icon. I can then position my mouse pointer on the area of the sky that I want to protect and then click. This is a useful method of protecting areas of the image from unwanted adjustments. To see how these different masks work together, click the icon at the top right of the control point list. This toggles the mask view for all the control points off and on rather than individual control points. If you don't do this, you'll be looking at the effect of individual masks, which can be confusing. When you look at the negative control point, you can see that it has the same design as the positive control point. The only difference between the two is the second slider below the size adjustment. On the negative control point, the opacity is now set to 0%, so it hides the filter's effect. Whilst on the positive control point, this opacity slider is set to 100%, so you see the effect. If I increase the opacity slider on the negative control point to 100%, you can see that it's then selecting part of the image. Then if I reduce the opacity on the positive control point, it's hiding that selection. This means we can control the strength of the overall filter effect using the global opacity slider, and we can control the strength of the filter's effect on individual control points by changing their opacity. Let's delete the negative control point we added and go back to our example of selecting the lichens on the rock. If I make the control point large enough to select the other areas, it also selects a lot of the sky. But when I reduce its size so that the sky isn't selected, it doesn't select the lichens on the rocks. Let's duplicate our control point now by clicking this icon below the control point list. You can see a new control point then added next to the one that was selected. We can then click and drag this to a new area of the rock to select that. Another way of duplicating a control point is by holding down the Option or Alt key on your keyboard and then clicking and dragging the control point. By creating multiple small control points, we can select irregular areas, although we still have a bit of overspill in the sky. But we can now manage that using negative control points and the opacity sliders of the control points themselves. Something else you can do is select all three control points together. You can do this in two ways. The first is by holding down your Command key or your Control key if you're on a PC, and then clicking each control point in the list. The selected control points then appear in orange. The other way to quickly select a group of control points is by clicking and dragging over them with your mouse. When you have all three control points selected, look what happens if we adjust the opacity slider of one of them. The opacity of the other control points then also changes. The same also happens when I resize one of the control points. Now this is a temporary grouping, meaning that if I click on another area, it deselects the control points. But we can also create a permanent group of control points. As before, select all the control points you want to group together. Then click the group icon to the bottom left of the control point list. As you can see, the three control points in the list are replaced by a single group. You'll also see that the ungroup icon now becomes available. When I click that, we see the three control points again. Let's regroup them though, because I want to show you a couple of other things about groups. Notice that we now have one control point with sliders, whilst the other two control points appear as dots. Despite this, if I move the opacity slider left and right, it's still controlling all three control points. Now watch what happens when I click one of the dots representing the other control points. All I see is a single slider controlling the size of that individual control point. Changing this slider doesn't affect the other control points. Something else I can do is click and drag individual control points in the group to reposition them. As I hope you've seen in this video, control points are extremely flexible and you should now have a good idea of how to work with them in Color Efex Pro. But to get the most value from control points, you need to know how to use the individual filters. That's why I recommend watching this video next. In it, I demonstrate how to produce impressive results using only a single filter. I hope you've enjoyed today's video, and if you haven't done so already, please take a moment to subscribe. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you soon.